for some time. I've known Trinity Jordan for years, a very, very long time, a good friend. We had lunch not that long ago, and he is, I remember in youth ministry days, just looking up to this guy is just absolutely incredible, just a great man of God and a great leader in any capacity. Let me read you a little bit of something, because this guy's resume is impressive. We are blessed to have Trinity here with us today. Trinity Jordan is the founding pastor of Elevation Church in Layton, Utah, and he is a frequent speaker at church planning events, conferences, college campuses, and churches around the world. Trinity has been the host of a television pilot series and has helped to train over 200 church planners and missionaries worldwide. In 2016, Trinity was appointed as assistant United States attorney for the Southern District of Florida. Just recently, Trinity and his wife, Amy, along with their two daughters, transitioned back to Utah, where they're now helping to plant churches and working on fighting the growing problem of human trafficking in the United States through working with the faith-based missionary effort called Free International. Trinity is a licensed attorney, a national speaker, an author of 3 books, and a leader of several nonprofit organizations. I can tell you that the message you're going to hear today, I have read his book, I have been a friend, and he has been a friend to me and a supporter, and of this church and of this school. So I'd love you to give a big hand right now for my friend and yours, Trinity Jordan. Give him a big hand, guys.
Now I am. Whoa. Yes, Lord? Hey, it's good to be here with you. I got to tell you that this is a little surreal for me in some regards, because the fact that this church has been instrumental in the life of my family. And so when I was a kid, I remember coming and visiting this church. So this might be one of the few places that I have had the opportunity to come speak at where I remember sitting as a child, and I mean, Pastor Crowder's been here forever, so yeah, I think it was Pastor Crowder back then. It was. And I remember seeing Pastor Crowder up on stage, and I remember telling my uncle, and because this was my uncle's church, that I would come and visit, and I would say, I want to go meet the pastor. And so my uncle would take me up to meet Pastor Crowder. So this is the first church that I've gotten to do anything like that. And as you'll hear a little bit about my story as I speak here this morning to you. So I'm excited to be here. And I'm also excited to be here because, as Pastor Rob said, I believe in this church. Because this church is instrumental in this community. And that's what churches should be. And that's what churches, that's plan A for God, is churches involved in their community, reaching out, being part of solutions and not problems. And that's what this church does. So I'm excited to be here. Thank you for being here with me, like you had a choice. And by the way, too, the jokes don't get any better throughout this. So it'll be a long 50 minutes or an hour and a half, however you decide to preach, you know, whatever. So you might as well just laugh with me. There's a table that's located right over here. And on that table is a copy of my latest book called Sabotage, How Insecurity Destroys Everything. And here's the great thing about, this is what I like to get up and you're like, this guy's peddling his book. Yep. Absolutely. And here's why. It's because this is the third book I've gotten the opportunity to write. In every single book, I've turned over the proceeds to those books to help some type of effort. The first book was to help plant the church in Utah. The second book was to help plant churches. And this third book, the proceeds today go to help fight human trafficking. So, I don't even know if this book's any good. I haven't read it yet, but I heard it's good. It's got like 5 stars on Amazon. So you should pick up a copy of this book today. Pick up a copy for your neighbors. Help be part of fighting human trafficking. And plus, my beautiful daughters that are going to be over there. I don't know, I said that in a place that has like a school. So, like, if you're under the age of 17, stay away from my daughters. They're going to be over there selling books. All right, so let's start. John chapter 20. If you have a Bible with you, you can turn there. So yes, here's the first question I always get asked. Yes, my name is Trinity. I did not change my name because I was going to work in churches or I was going to be a pastor or the day I got saved, it wasn't like, I'm changing my name to Trinity. My dad saw some old spaghetti Western movies. Some of you apparently have seen them. The cowboy's name was Trinity. In fact, that those were the titles of the movies. Trinity, Trinity is my name is still Trinity. Yeah, my dad saw those movies. So I was named Trinity. And I grew up all over the world. We moved every year to a different place, and I even got the opportunity to live in Italy. My senior year of high school, we moved here to Utah. And along that journey of having the name Trinity, like I hated the name Trinity. Hated the name Trinity. It sounds like a horse in the Kentucky Derby owned by a Catholic charity. Just being honest. So I would go by the name TJ. That was my, I'm going to go by my initials. My name is TJ. Everywhere I went, what's your name? TJ. Why I hated my name. I'll get back to moving to Utah. But we moved to Utah, and we start going to some churches. And I didn't really grow up in a religious family. I mean, we were Catholic, but that meant like you go to church when grandma's in town or Easter and Christmas, right? Some of you were Catholic. And so here I am going to churches. I get to the point where I come to salvation in God. And this is the point where things start to change for me in life. But here is what happened to me. This might not be your story, but this is my story. When I would go to church and I would see the people that would stand on these stages. And to me, when they would talk and they would tell their stories and when they would articulate the scriptures, it was like they had a cape on their shoulders. And I would look at them and I'd be like, that's not me. I'm not like that. They're a superhero. Not me. I will never be like that. And then I would pick up the pages of the Bible and I would read. And I'd read the stories of our heroes of faith, the men and women in there. And when I would read those stories, it was like they had capes on their shoulders. Like the first Marvel comic right there, you know? Superheroes. And I was like, that's not me. Here's what I learned, though. As I followed God, that if you and I, if we'll slow down a little bit when we read our sacred literature, you'll realize, like I did, that the people that we encounter in the pages of Scripture are just like you and me. And they are messed up. All of them. Just like you and just like me. They ain't got no cape on their shoulders. They're real people with real problems. And that's what I saw through the pages of Scripture. I'm going to show you that today, this morning. Take a walk with me. John chapter 20. We're going to start verse 1. Now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came early to the tomb while it was still dark, and she saw the stone already taken away from the tomb. Verse 2. So she ran and came to Simon Peter and to the other disciple whom Jesus loved. What a jab at Peter there. And said to them, they've taken away the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they've laid him. Okay, now listen. Stop for a minute. Now during this time period, if you were going to write a narrative, if you were going to write the story to recount an event that took place, during this time period, you would not use personal pronouns. You would not say I, you would not say we. What you would do is you would come up with a descriptive phrase to describe yourself within the text, within this narrative, within this story. And so John, our boy John, in the Gospel of John, has come up with that. He's writing this narrative and this story, and he's telling you about himself in this time with Peter going to the tomb. And he's come up with the phrase, the disciple whom Jesus loved. That's the phrase he's come up with to describe himself. Here's what I think is awesome about that and humorous, is we know from what scholars have told us that John is the last gospel out of the four gospels to be written. And by the time John writes his gospel, all the other 11 disciples have passed on. We know Judas committed suicide. The other 10 have been martyred at this point. So John writes his gospel and he's like, I'm the one whom Jesus loved. What? No objections from the rest of the boys in the team? They're all dead. It's kind of like he waited till everybody else was gone. He's like, yeah, okay, I guess I should tell them how it really was. This is tongue-in-cheek, people, tongue-in-cheek. Verse 3. So Peter and the other disciple went forth, and they were going to the tomb. Verse 4. And the two were running together, and the other disciple ran ahead faster than Peter and came to the tomb first. Ah, which disciple are you? Well, I'm the one whom Jesus loved, and I'm faster than Peter. Verse 5, and stooping and looking in, he saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. And so Simon Peter also came following him and entered the tomb, and he saw the linen wrappings lying there, and the face cloth, which had been on his head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Verse 8, so the other disciple who had first come to the tomb then also entered, and he saw and believed. Okay, so here it is. Ah, yes, the disciple whom Jesus loved. Ah, yes, the disciple who ran faster than Peter. Ah, yes, the disciple who entered the tomb and saw everything, and he believed. Which one are you? That's who I am. The one who Jesus loved, the one who's a faster runner, and I'm not like unbelieving Peter over there, I believe. Here is the narrative, the story, the whole reason you and I are at church this morning. This is the crescendo of Christendom. This is what it means. This is where our salvation comes from. The tomb is empty. But Peter wants, or John wants you to know, the tomb's empty, and I'm a faster runner. So if we slow down, we see that laced amongst this pivotal story, this amazing redemption, the whole reason why you and I have hope and faith, laced in the middle of this is this petty rivalry between John and Peter. Side by side, these stories sit. Who is more of a man of faith, Peter or John? Who is more loved by Jesus, Peter or John? Who is a faster runner, Peter or John? All right, turn with me now to chapter 21, just very next chapter. It's the last chapter in John. These are the final moments of Jesus' life here on earth with his disciples. They're actually having like a fish fry on the Sea of Galilee, which I've never experienced one of these, but apparently this is where you catch fish right away and then cook it right away. I'm a city boy. We go to Harmon's. Verse 15. So when they'd finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? And he said to him, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. He said, tend my lambs, which would have meant, and Peter would have understood this to mean that take care of my people, take care of those that are following after me, take care of those who I shepherd. Verse 16, and he said to him again a second time, Simon, son of John, do you love me? And he said to him, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. And he said to him, shepherd my sheep. Verse 17, he said to him a third time, Simon, son of John, do you love me? So Jesus asked this question three times. This is like side note. This is the brain of Trinity Jordan. I think that the reason why he's asking him three times is he's kind of letting him know, like, dude, you denied me three times, and I want you to understand that I know that. So he's kind of putting them on blast. For those of you that don't know what I just said, that means he's calling him out. Peter was grieved because he said to him, the third time, do you love me? And he said to him, Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you. And Jesus said to him, tend my sheep. Skip down here to verse 20. Peter, turning around, saw the disciple whom Jesus loved following them. The one who had also leaned back on his bosom at the supper and said, Lord, who is it that betrays you? Verse 21. So Peter, seeing him, said to Jesus, Lord, what about this man? Now here's this sacred, holy moment that Peter is having with Jesus. If I was to say to any of you in this room, listen, you're going to get a time when Jesus is going to sit with you and he's going to tell you the purpose he has for your life, you would sign up in a heartbeat. You'd be, I want to be part of that. And you listen to every word that Jesus said. You'd probably be taking notes. And this moment is happening for Peter. And all Peter can think about, what does John get? Is he getting something better? What about this guy? Verse 22. And Jesus said to him, if I want him to remain until I come, what is that to you? You follow me. Verse 23, therefore, this saying went out among the brethren that the disciple would not die. Yet Jesus did not say to him that he would not die, but only, if I want him to remain until I come, what is that to you? That's because back then, people would take Jesus' words and they would twist them and make them mean something that they, we don't have that problem today. Don't worry about that. So Jesus says, what is that to you? How many times are you and I invited to follow this resurrected Christ? And we have this unique calling in our lives, and we're sidetracked because we're thinking about this person over there or that person over there. What do they get? Why do they get that opportunity? Why wasn't I given that? Why did you bring me into this family, God? Why didn't we have these opportunities? Why? And we compare and we contrast and we want some other life rather than the life that God has given us. How many times do we let that distract us, bog us down, get us away from the unique calling that God has for our life? Turn with me to Genesis 27. I'll get there in a moment, though. I told you I hated the name Trinity, and I went by TJ. Hated it, but I went by TJ. When I came to know God and started following after God, it was at those moments in my life that I embraced the name Trinity, because I realized that TJ, for me, was just me hiding from who I really was, even the name that my parents had given me. And it was at that point that I started embracing the name Trinity. So I told you that my senior year of high school, we moved to Utah, and my name is Trinity in Utah. My name is Trinity. I hope I'm connecting these dots for you. So basically, every time somebody met me, my name was, hi, I'm not Mormon, right? Like right away. I didn't have to say anything else. They knew, like, nobody that's LDS names their kid Trinity. So my senior year of high school, this is funny, I'm telling these stories, Pastor Rob, but I don't know if I've ever told a lot of these stories in Layton, where I actually graduated from high school and stuff. Like, yeah, people here, you probably are like, what? I remember that. Yeah, exactly. So I graduated from Northridge High School. It was a brand new school at the time, and graduated from Northridge, and one of my teachers there, she would come to me all the time, and she'd be like, hey, let's talk about religion. It was a different time then, people. It was a different time. And so I would. And so one day, she comes to me and she's like, you know what? You need to meet my daughter. And I'm thinking to myself, your daughter? teacher's trying to pawn her daughter off on me. Woof, you know, that's what I'm thinking. So I go to this school event, and her daughter actually went to a different high school, and she brought her daughter to this school event. And as soon as I saw her daughter, I was like, jackpot, you know? So we started hanging out, and we became friends, and then we started dating, and I took her to church on a Wednesday night, and was at a point in the service where they asked if anybody wanted to give their life to Jesus that night, and they were talking about grace, and they were talking about mercy, and they were talking just the gospel message, and you know, and she went to the front, and she prayed, and she raised her hand, and if you can imagine, my teacher hated me at that point, and then she really hated me when we got married later on in college. It's all right. You can clap. We have a great relationship now when she's asleep. I love my in-laws. I really do. So Utah's home now for a lot of reasons, and Utah has become the place where I've learned who God has called me to be, my identity in Christ, embracing and understanding the name Trinity. And here's the reason why I tell you that story. It wasn't until I embraced who I was, Trinity, when I embraced this, when God started using me. It was almost like when God said, you're finally okay in your own skin, Trinity. You're finally okay with that. Now I'm going to use you. Because see, here's the thing is, and I know there's a lot of military in here. My stepdad worked for the government, and so we moved every single year. I've been all over the United States and even overseas. And so every time we moved and we went to a different state and I went to a different school, I could change who I was because nobody knew me at the last place. So I would show up someplace and I'd go to school and they'd go, hey, you want to be on the baseball team? And I'd be like, I want to be on the baseball team. And they're like, hey, did you play baseball at your last school that you went to? I was like, yep. And then I'd show up to the next school and they'd be like, hey, you want to be on the football team? I was like, I want to be on the football team. Did you play at the last school you were at? I'm like, yeah. I was like, I started. I could reinvent myself every place I went. One place we moved, it was big poofy starter coats that everybody had. I was like, I gotta get a big poofy starter coat. That was a disaster. Because my mom's the one that went and bought that. It was a Mighty Ducks starter coat, you know? Oh, thanks, Mom. And then we moved to Arkansas. Now, I know you're thinking in your head, like, Arkansas, everyone's got a little piece of hay or something in their mouth and overalls. But it was, like, super preppy in Arkansas. So in Arkansas, it was, Mom, I got to wear Tommy Hilfiger. I got to be, like, polo. We got to always have, like, the polo shirts. And I got to like, really dress up nice, Mom. I got to really fit in. I got to be preppy here. And that's what I did when I was in Arkansas. This is every place I moved, every place I lived, I tried to be something I wasn't. The reason why is because I wasn't happy with me until I found God, until I came to know God, until I embraced the fact that I'm Trinity. Look at Genesis 27. I'll catch you up to what's going on here because we don't have time to go through all of Genesis, though I would love to. Genesis 27, by the time we get to this portion of Scripture, we're going to start in verse 18, is we've got these two brothers. They're actually twins, Esau and Jacob. And Esau is the firstborn. And a lot of people don't realize this, and they run through Scripture too fast, but Esau, the Scripture tells us, he's a man's man. They say that he's like this hairy man's man. He's the guy that should have his reality TV show where he's out just, they don't even give him a weapon to go out and hunt. He just uses his hands. just runs after the deer and tackles him and rips him apart. And he's like, I caught it. You know, like that's Esau. And they say that he's hairy. Not a little bit hairy, a lot hairy. Like the guy that takes off his sweater and he's still wearing a sweater, hairy. You don't believe me? I'm going to point this out to you. Verse 18. So here's what's happening. Is there is this, in this culture, there was this symbolic gesture called a blessing that the father would give to his eldest son. And Jacob, the younger brother, decides, I want that blessing. I want what's supposed to be Esau's, because I don't want to be the second. I want to be the first. So what he does is he dresses up like his brother. And his dad, the text says that his dad's eyes have become dim, so his dad's losing his eyesight. And what Jacob does is he puts animal furs on his arms. Listen, my friends, if you are so hairy that somebody dresses up like you and they use animal pelt to recreate your hairiness, you need to go to doctor. That's Teen Wolf right there. So it also says in the text, I don't know why, all these little things just always pop up to me when I'm reading it. It says in the text that he puts on his brother's clothes and that there's this smell that's associated with his brother. I don't know, his brother wore Brute, I don't know, or Old Spice. He's got to make sure he had that cologne on. Okay, they didn't have that back then, just so you know, okay? Whew, geez. Verse 18, then he came to his father and he said, my father, and he said to him, here I am. Who are you, my son? Well, let me stop right there. Jewish storytellers during this time period, we don't really have anything like this in our literary devices in the way in which we write, but this was very common for them at that time. Is that the first words that somebody says in the narrative, in the story that's going on, are key to the whole arc of that character. So they Jewish storytellers want you to understand this is what they're saying at the very beginning. Pay attention to it because it's the story that you need to follow. So check this out. Here's the first words out of Jacob's mouth. Jacob said to his father, I am Esau, your firstborn. I have done as you told me. Get up, please, sit and eat of my game that you may bless me. So when we first meet Jacob, Jacob is pretending to be somebody else. First identity theft in human history, right here. Where was LifeLock? Verse 24, and he said, are you really my son Esau? And he said, I am. So when we meet Jacob, Jacob is pretending to be somebody else. He doesn't want to be Jacob. He wants to be Esau. He wants what the firstborn is supposed to get. He doesn't like who he is. All right, skip with me now to Genesis 32. It's five chapters later. If you got your Bible, turn with me there. Let me tell you what takes place in five chapters. There's a lot going on here. So, Jacob's successful. He's stolen his brother's identity. He's gotten the blessing from his father. His father has blessed him. Esau finds out about this, and Esau's ticked. In fact, Esau wants to kill him because of it. Mom finds out about it. Mom's like, you know what? You're at the right age. You need to get married. Makes sense. You should go to a family reunion to find your wife. That's a joke. People are like, yeah, that makes sense. So she says, why don't you go see my brother? He lives really far away. It's your uncle. He's got a wife for you. So that's what happens. Jacob leaves. He goes really far away. He goes to his brothers or his uncles. And he ends up marrying one of his cousins, two of his cousins. It's a crazy story. It's like based in southern Utah, right? I'm glad you like these jokes. Because they kill in Ohio. They kill. So, it doesn't just marry two, but he ends up with his cousins' wives, also their maids. So he has four wives. by the time he walks out of that place, and lots of children. And he is blessed, blessed. He's rich. He has it all. And so by the time we get to Genesis 32, here's what happens. He's got four wives. He's got lots of children. And he's got lots of wealth. And he's now on his way home, back home. He's heard that his dad has passed. He's heard that his mom has passed. And now he's home. But on his way home, he hears that Esau is on his way with a bunch of men to greet him along the journey. Now remember, the last time he remembers anything about Esau, Esau wanted to kill him. Now Esau's coming with a bunch of men towards him. So here's what the text says along this way as we get to Genesis 32. Jacob takes like all of his servants that are over all the camels, and he's like, look, guys, you go ahead, and you're going to come to my brother Esau and all these men. You're going to bow to him, and you're going to say, we are your servants, and these are your camels. And then he goes to all of his servants that are over all the sheep, and he's like, look, here's what you're going to do. You're going to go ahead of us. When you get to my brother, you're going to bow to him and say, we are your servants, and these are all of your sheep. And he does this for all of his livestock. He does this for everything he owns. In fact, he even gets to the point where he says to his wives and his, like when you got to pluralize that, it's always interesting, right? I don't believe in plural marriage because the Bible says you can only serve one master. So it's a joke, people. Pastor Crowder was awesome. This guy just told a bunch of polygamy jokes the whole time. It was incredible. So he takes his wives and he takes all of his kids and he says, look, you guys go ahead of me. And when you get to my brother, bow to him. And hopefully he will spare your lives because I'm not there. So by the time we get to Genesis 32, Jacob is completely alone. It's just him. And he's in the wilderness. And think about this. He stole the blessing from his brother. And in Genesis 32, when we see Jacob, he's given everything that he's stolen, all of his blessing, back to his brother. He's given it all away. In fact, the name Jacob actually means deceiver. And he's all by himself in 32. Now, there's this crazy story that happens in 32, and we're going to read a little bit about it. But in the middle of the night, while he's sleeping on a rock, an angel man comes to him. I'm going to call it an angel man. This angel man comes to him and wrestles with him like a full-on fight in the middle of the desert. It's a crazy story. So let's pick up there, verse 26. They're fighting, they're wrestling. Verse 26, then he said, this is the angel man, says, let me go, for the dawn is breaking. But he said, and this is Jacob, I will not let you go unless you bless me. He's obsessed with blessings. Verse 27, and he said to him, what is your name? And he said, Jacob. When we first meet Jacob, Jacob wishes he was someone else. And now he is completely by himself. He's not wealthy. He's poor. He owns nothing. It's just Jacob. And when he's asked, who are you? I'm Jacob. My name means deceiver. I'm Jacob. He's finally comfortable in his own skin. Finally. Look at verse 28. And he said, your name shall no longer be Jacob, but Israel, for you have striven, maybe your Bible says struggled, maybe your Bible says wrestled with God and with men and have prevailed. Well, first thing I want to say when I read this is I'm going, man, this guy has taken how many years to get comfortable with the fact that he's Jacob and now you change his name? He's like, now your name's going to be Israel. He's like, what? But here's the other thing is this angel man says, listen, you've been wrestling with God and with others, and you've succeeded. He's poor. He has nothing. Somebody's on his way to possibly kill him. I think in that moment he's going, what? I've succeeded. maybe the wrestle and the struggle is you're now comfortable being you. Now I can use you. Now God can use you. Maybe this isn't Jacob's story. Maybe this is our story. Maybe this is what it is with you and I, is that we're not okay with what God has created. We're not okay with what God has given us. And so in the back of our minds, we wish we were richer. We wish we were bigger. We wish we were smaller. We wish we were shorter. We wish we were taller. We wish we were prettier. We wish we grew up over there. We wish we had that opportunity. We wish we went and did that in our former life. We wish, we wish, we wish. Maybe this is what it means to be human, that deep down inside, we're just not comfortable with who we are. And we start to blame God for the circumstances that we find ourselves in. And because we blame God for the circumstances we find ourselves in, we never really connect with God the way we're intended to connect with God. And maybe because we're constantly comparing ourselves to the people around us, why did they get that? Why did they get that opportunity? Maybe that's why we don't connect with people the way we're supposed to, because we're constantly resentful. Maybe this is what it means to be human. I think you can make the argument that one of our central struggles as human beings is that we're not okay with what God made. And so one of the reasons we struggle is because of that. But the angel man, he looked at Jacob, he said, you've wrestled with this. You've struggled with this. And you prevailed because you're okay being Jacob. And now God can use you. See, throughout the whole Old Testament, you'll always see the fathers of Israel, the fathers of Judaism, is Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. These are the fathers that carry on the bloodline to Jesus. But God can't use Jacob until Jacob is okay with being Jacob. And how can God use Jacob when Jacob wishes he was someone else? And so Jesus says to Peter, what is that to you? And Jesus responds to Peter's question with a question. And I'm going to do that this morning. How many times do you let your joy get stolen? Because you're comparing yourself. Because you want something else. That you've bought into this marketing of American culture that you need something else to be happy. How many times do you let that happen? And how many times do you keep yourself from being who God created you to be? See, here's the great thing about our text, our scripture, our sacred text. Is that Jesus created you. God knew you in the womb. And he knew everything that you were going to go through. And he knew all the opportunities you were going to have. And he needs you to be you. That's what he needs. Your plan A. There is no plan B. You're it. Plan A. All right, turn with me to Exodus 20. This is the last place I'll take you in Scripture. You're like, man, this guy's been all over the Bible today. Exodus chapter 20. If you've spent any time in church, you probably have a flanograph of this somewhere. This is the Ten Commandments come up in Exodus 20. You are correct if you came up with that. And here's the great thing about the Ten Commandments in Exodus 20. You've probably heard somebody preach, teach this portion, and it's great theology. They'll talk to you about how the Ten Commandments, you can divide the Ten Commandments in that if like six of them, five of them, whatever, are about how we relate to God, and the other half are about how we relate to other people. And that's good. That's good. Here's what I want to draw out today and what I want to point out to you this morning is that the Jewish scholars, though, for years have debated the Ten Commandments. Not because of the God versus each other thing. Jewish scholars have debated these, and this has been their debate. Why are the first nine commandments, or why are nine of these commandments what we would call externally observable? And why is the Tenth Commandment not? And see, listen, all of Leviticus and what we find in Deuteronomy is just the legislation of the Ten Commandments. How do they legislate out the Ten Commandments in their culture at their time? So here's what I mean by that. You're like, some of you are like, man, this guy's getting deep. Pastor Rob, you're going to have to explain this with your master's degree. So, like, thou shalt not murder. You could see somebody murder somebody else. That's externally observable. You could see it. You could see someone steal stuff. You could see it. You could see someone when they dishonor their parents. Right, daughters? That's my favorite verse of all of Scripture, by the way. Like, you could see someone bow down and worship another god. You can see those things. But you can't see someone break the 10th commandment. Let me read it to you. Verse 17. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or his male servant, or his female servant, or his Maserati, or his ox. Oh, you guys don't know Hebrew? That's in there. Or his donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. You can't see that. Like, if I'm having a coveting party in my head right now, you can't see it. I could. So this has been the debate amongst Jewish scholars. Why would God give us a commandment that you can't see happening in somebody's life, and how do we enforce that? That's been the debate. And so why is the 10th commandment so different than the other nine? So there's this ancient Jewish commentary that says this about the 10th commandment, and I like how they phrase this. It says this, that the 10th commandment is a reward. And this is what the scholar says, that when you worship God and only God, and when you follow what God has laid out in life, you're not murdering others, you're honoring the father and mother that God has given you, you're not taking from others that you haven't worked for, that when you follow God, by the time you get to the 10th commandment, you're not going to want anybody else's life. You're not going to want anything that's not already given to you. It's the reward of following after God. And we see Peter, Jesus saying, I have this amazing life for you. And Jesus says, well, what about him? Is this going to be fair? And God says, what is that to you? Think of all the petty ways in which we rate ourselves, which we compare ourselves, which we long for something that we don't have. And here's what I want to end with today, church. In fact, if I can invite our worship team to come up here with me. There always comes a point in our journey with God in which you're confronted with who you are. And for some of us, that's a Jacob moment where you go, I'm a deceiver. Look at all the things I've done wrong. This is who I am and this is what I've done. And then there's some of us that God has blessed us with. Amazing stuff like a Peter. But we're looking to the right and left to see maybe somebody else has something more, something better. But there's always this point when you follow God in which you're confronted with who you are. And God asks you, what is your name? My encouragement to you this morning is that when that happens, when God says, "What is your name?" that you can respond, "Sam, I'm Trinity. I'm Amy. I'm Mariah. I'm Lauren. I'm Shane. I'm Frank. I'm Alexis." That you can respond with your name. And I promise you that when you finally get comfortable with you, God can use you. And God will use you. The tomb is empty. You don't have to worry about being a faster runner. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come into this room today and we sing these songs of worship to you, and we give of our finances to that of which you blessed us. We get to hang out with our friends, family members. We even have come forward and prayed with you and asked you, God, to intervene in our lives. This has been our day, God, our worship to you, our time that we set aside to come together to do this. But in the midst of this, God, we've also dug into your sacred literature. And we've heard the stories of Peter and Jacob, which really are our stories, God. God, help us to be comfortable with being us. Help us, God, to embrace the unique calling that you have given us. Help us to stand tall, being the person that you created us to be. I pray that as we walk out of this room here today, God, that that's what we will take with us, is a renewed sense of self-confidence because we are who you created. If you'll keep your eyes closed and your heads bowed, I really think that some of you need to hear this morning, that God is speaking to you and he needs to remind you. Some of you need to hear this. You are not your mother. You are not your father. You are not your brother. You are not your sister. You are not your neighbor. You are not your classmate. You are uniquely and wonderfully made by God. Not a mistake. Not destroyed by this world. But God's loving, precious property. You're his children. Be that. Live that. God, let us be that. Let us walk out of here with our heads high, our arms wide, embraced by you and your love. We pray this in the name above all other names, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Thank you, church, for letting me be here with you today.
Hey, CLC family, can we give...